I want to talk today about free software business models and what changed there over the last few years and the new challenge we are facing, and try to also discuss with you later on how a solution could look like to this challenge and to these changes. So why do we talk about business models at all? I think that's really important because I believe that free software and software freedom is there for everybody. So everybody should have it. It's not just a community thing for home users, but everybody, also big and small enterprises, should have software freedom. And this means, of course, we want to conquer the world, right? And in an ideal world for us, everybody, no matter if it's a home user or an enterprise, could do all their stuff with free software and don't have to use non-free software. But this means that it's not enough to just maintain the status quo, just maintain the existing free software out there, which you might be able to do with relatively less effort. But what you really want to do is you want to innovate and really compete with all the big non-free software out there. And if you want to innovate and really compete with them, then I think you need to find business models and a way to have also bigger free software organizations which can really innovate and take some time to invest into free software and build a product until a stage where it can really compete. So that's why I think free software business models are really important. And if you look at the history of free software and what we have achieved until now, I think that's already amazing because we have 75% of all mobile phones running free software, at least to a large extent. Not completely, but already to a large extent. A lot of IoT devices running free software, all the top 500 supercomputers running free software. And also if you look at the cloud computing, which came up the last years as infrastructure as a service especially, all these platforms running free software to a large extent. If you go to Amazon, every operating which runs there is some kind of free software. And even in Azure, there was a statistic which came out, I think, earlier this year, where even in Azure these days, more than 50% of all operating systems are some variant of a GNU Linux operating system. So even on the Microsoft platform, free software is everywhere these days. So you could imagine that or could think that it's a bright future and everything is fine. But why still a lot of companies struggling to make money with free software these days? And I think if you look at free software business models, you can go through three waves and three stages how this evolved over the time. If you look at the beginning of free software in the early 80s, it's quite funny for me because how free software was invented from Richard Stallman back then, he doesn't care about making money or business model, he just wants to give freedom to the people. But still, when he started with his GNU project, he immediately quit his job at the MIT because he wanted to avoid that some of the organizations can claim the copyright and claim his work for them. So he quit his job so that he can work on free software and building free software. And then, of course, right at the beginning, he faced the problem how to make money to pay my living. And back then it was relatively easy because many people didn't have the internet connection. The internet connection was super slow. So a valid business model was to just put the free software on tapes and later on CDs and then sell these tapes and CDs to the people who want to have free software. And then they can order it by you and you send it to them and then they are happy to have this free software. And this worked quite well. There are a lot of companies were created this way. Also all the Linux distribution, Red Hat, SUSE, and if you back in the 90s, if you go to a computer shop, you got all the boxes with the Linux distributions, also stuff like Debian, the more community-driven distributions, all were packed up in nice boxes with a handbook and CDs, and you can buy them. And this was a valid business model for many companies. This even grew that far that Red Hat become this way the first 1 billion free software company. They become really big with this. And then if you think about Red Hat, we already see the first shift in these business models because for me, one keystone was 2003 at the early 20,000 years when Red Hat decided that it's no longer a valid business model to sell home user, end user desktop operating system. So they stopped selling Red Hat as a desktop operating system and transferred this into Fedora, a completely community-driven distribution. And they started with what I would call the second wave of business models. They started to selling services around the software. So they concentrate and they start to concentrate more on the big enterprises, which were in this stage and building up more and more servers because they had to use or provide more and more services in their own organization, but also for people outside. So the number of servers grow and the number of services grow. And they needed all the software, and you could sell them all the services around it, the SLAs, long-time maintenance, the custom development, all the things you can think about, you could sell to them. And this made Red Hat really big, and this worked for quite a long time as a free software business model. But then at some point, the third wave started, and everything moved to the cloud. What you see today that more and more organizations, if they think that the number of services they have still grows, but if they are at a point where they have to set up a new service in their organization, they consider or think about, do we do this on our own hardware, in our own servers, or do we go to any infrastructure as a service provider and rent there our infrastructure? And if they think about it, they will notice a lot of benefits if they go for this infrastructure as a service providers. Often this is way cheaper. You can easily scale it because you don't buy real hardware. You just buy this virtual hardware. So you start just with one setup you think works for your service. And if you realize you need more RAM, more CPU power, more storage, you just go to the control center, do a few clicks, and you have what you want. You also don't have to care if something breaks, if a hard disk breaks or something. That's all abstracted away from you. You just have your platform configured the way you need it, and it just runs. If you need to have more redundancy, security, backup strategy, everything, you don't really have to care. They provide you all the services around it and all the functionality. So you can really easily spin up your infrastructure, and then you put your service on top of it. So from a company who are looking into the next service they want to deploy, this often sounds like a really nice idea, beside the obvious questions if you ask yourself, where are my data stored, who has control about it? But that's often things they think about in the second or third step, or many companies, unfortunately, don't think about this at all. But a big drawback about this is, if you think about the companies behind the software they are using on the cloud infrastructure now, because this infrastructure as a service provider are large organizations. So they have the people to run the software and to make sure that this runs really smoothly and this is scalable and this is secure. They even don't care if this is licensed under strong copyleft license, because that's not their value they are selling. So they are happy to comply with an HGPL and give all the people the source code and the rights given by the HGPL. That's no problem for them. They even don't have a threat of forking. So if really the license changes in a way where they really don't like it, they're even ready to fork the software and just do it by their own. And this creates a big problem, in my opinion, because this infrastructure as a service companies are so huge and have this manpower knowledge, they will not buy a subscription from Red Hat, from SUSE, from a database vendor, from whoever, because they say, we have the people, we know, we can run this safely, securely, we don't need your service you're offering anymore. And if they don't need a service, then the customer of the infrastructure as a service providers also no longer need a subscription, because they say, why should I buy a Red Hat subscription? This infrastructure as a service provider already provide me all the infrastructure, and they take care that everything works and nothing breaks. So nobody any longer goes to the service to companies behind the software and buying one of their services, which makes many companies big in the past. So when this happened, you saw a few first reactions from many companies. One reaction was from Redis. They introduced the commons clause, which changed the license a little bit, made it actually non-free. So they said, you still have a lot of the freedoms given by free software, but you are no longer allowed to use this as a commercial service and do no consulting and support around the software. So this way they try to avoid that these big cloud companies can take the software and provide the services. But if they want to do it, they have to come to them and try ask them for different license, pay them some money to get an exception or the license to do it. But of course, what has happened this way, the software turns into non-free software. And it not only hurts these big cloud companies, which was intended, but it also hurts the whole free software ecosystem around it. Because if you look in your local areas, we have a lot of small consulting companies these days, which also offers consulting around various free software components. And they are also all hidden by this clause. They also no longer can provide the services. So you don't only, you have many drawbacks. You turn this into non-free software, and you heard the whole free software ecosystem around it. Another approach was from MongoDB. They created the server-side public license, and what they did basically is they took the HGPL and extended the aspect of copyleft. So they said, okay, now copyleft is not only about all the derivative work of our software, but this means all the software you need around it to run the services. So if you have this in your cloud infrastructure, this also the operating system, the database, your backup system, your monitoring system, everything is subject to our new license. And if you want to our software, we have to release all the stuff as free software. And this way they wanted to scare away the cloud providers to use their software, or again ask them for an exception and pay for it. And again, this turns the software into non-free software. And also legally, it's a huge questions if you can even enforce these rules, because these are really broad rules. So the chance is also high that you will never be able to enforce these rules. And the third license which came up over the last two years is the Confluence Community License, which also just prohibits the use of the software as any service, which has the same problem as the Redis changes. So what does this mean at the end? So if you look at these license changes, of course, the two obvious outcomes are they succeed with these changes or they fail with these changes. So if they succeed with the changes, they can secure their company and their business, but we will lose all the free software and all the ecosystem. So that's obviously bad for the whole free software ecosystem. The other thing is if they fail with these license changes and the cloud providers will not care about it, then, of course, they... cloud provider can go on happily, but we will lose then all this company behind the software, which will hurt our ecosystem immense, in my opinion, because who will develop all this databases, infrastructure, distributions? Who will work on this if the companies behind it have a problem to make money with this business? As I said before, they are ready to fork also some projects, and they might be able to, this is one of two, but they will never be able to fork the whole stack and carry this on by their own. So I think they will also create a problem for themselves in the long run this way. Another thing which I thought was already on the way to dying is the open core business model, but I have the feeling that this now in this new situation also came up a little bit again. There was even a huge open core conference this year in the US where a lot of people gathered together to describe this as the new future of free software business models, which I think is a bad idea, because for open core, your business model is not a free software business model, it's a non-free software business model, because all the money you make it with non-free software, and the free software is just a byproduct. And this also adds a lot of wrong intentions to the company, because if you make the money with the non-free part, you always have the incentive to shrink the free part and increase the non-free part, because that's where you make money. You also often scare the community away, because if someone from the community comes and implements a feature which is available only in the non-free part as free software, then of course you have to forbid them to merge this into your main branch, because otherwise you would hurt your business model and your product you are selling. So this hurts free software and the community in many aspects. And I find it sad that with these changes, I have the feeling that this is a little bit on the rise again. Another approach which is completely different is because compared to all the other approach, at least this ends at the end of the road to free software. That's what MariaDB said. They said, okay, we have a license and it grants you a lot of freedoms, but the author of the software is allowed to place some restrictions in it. And for MariaDB, place this restriction in it that you can create a database cluster with up to 3 nodes, but not more. But there's a termination clause in it, so the restriction has to end at least after 4 years. You can also reduce the time as an author, but you can't increase it. So 4 years is the maximum you can set. And after the 4 years, the software will turn into free software. By default, into the GPL license, but as an author, you can also define another license. It just has to be GPL compatible. So at least I think that's also by far not a good solution, but at least that's a solution where at the end of the road, we end up at free software again. So maybe that's the best middle ground we have at the moment. Also, I think we should need to seek for better solutions. But now I talked a lot about negative stuff and about how people try to work around this new world. But there are also positive examples. For example, this year, Chef announced to release all their complete software stack as free software. And they even were so optimistic that this works for them that they even decided to not choose a protecting free software license. So they went with the Apache license. And if you read the announcement, there are many great quotes in there. I now picked this one, but I think from the mindset, they are definitely on the right track here. And I really hope for them that this works out, because this would then be a counterexample to what all the other companies experience at the moment. So my question here at the end, do we need new free software business models? And of course, if we need new free software business models, then the question is, how do they look like? How will the future of free software business models look like? Are we going back to more of the small, decentralized consulting companies? Might be an option. But then, as I said in the introduction, I fear that we are losing the innovation part. Then with small consulting companies, we might be able to maintain existing software. But can we re-innovate and compete with the big non-free software companies and can also come up with the next new innovation or even keep up with them? I think that's really hard. Maybe that's also one of my hope. Maybe the infrastructure service providers out there might at some point realize that what they are doing is hurting their business model in the long run as well. Because if all these companies behind the software they are using have struggling to making money and maybe losing the whole company goes down, then at the end they will also have a problem because they will also lose the software, which is the foundation of their service they are offering. So maybe they will realize early enough that this is also a problem for them and then decide that they find a way to share the revenue also with the projects they are working on. Or there are completely new free software business models out there. And of course, the main question, if you think about free software models, is always what value can I as a company add to a free software solutions? Because I need to find something others are willing to pay for. I think that's always the challenge. Maybe one suggestion I also read in the last few days is this was, I think, also an idea for comment from Chef, from the CEO there, that he means that the main value you can add and where you can also outperform the cloud providers is that if you have your company who built the software is really innovative and have a fast development with many new features coming in all the time, and then you are the market leader no matter what they are, they will always come back to you because you are the most innovative one and the one with most features. Maybe that's a way, but I also see some problems there if this becomes a race where everybody then tries to run faster and at some point you come to a limit, right? And then what happens then? So this was my summary. So I'm also curious to hear about from you. What do you think? Is this a real problem? Do you see any solution to it? Thank you very much.